everybody, and welcome to Spring Festival at the British Library. My name is Kisley Lenore, and I'm the Creative Industries Marketing Manager and Programmer of this festival. Spring Festival is our celebration of fashion, film, and design. Right, so now I have the pleasure of introducing our speakers. I'll introduce them together, but Amber is going to speak first. So Amber Butchart has had a lifelong love affair with dressing up and has turned this obsession into a career as a fashion historian, writer, and broadcaster. She has contributed to productions for BBC 1 and 2, Radio 4, and Sky Arts, amongst others. And as half of the Broken Hearts DJ duo, she co-hosts a weekly show on Jazz FM focusing on interwar music and culture. She's an associate lecturer in cultural and historical studies at London College of Fashion and a former research fellow at the University of the Arts London, which is where this research stems from. She is currently writing a book on a history of nautical style to be published next year. Chris Laverty is a writer and broadcaster and the creator of Clothes on Film, the definite costume and film resource on the internet. He has been featured on BBC Radio, HBO Television, and in countless publications discussing fashion in movies and television. He was personally approached by Deborah Landis to be involved with a recent Hollywood costume exhibit in the V&A. Where he also wrote a chapter for the accompanying book. He currently has a column called The Fabric of Cinema in the Pan India publication Arts Illustrated, as well as regularly contributing to online style magazine Mr. Porter. And he can normally be found with a Gibson cocktail in his hand. Right, so Amber, you're up first.
For coming, everybody, first of all. Just check. Yes, it's working. Brilliant. So far, so good. Well, my story tonight is a tale of three cities, of hedonism and economic depression, and most importantly, of the relationship between fashion and film. The three cities in question are Paris, the epicentre of fashion since the 17th century, Hollywood, a major centre of film production since early in the 20th century, and London, that kind of sits somewhere between the two. So let's start with the city that we're in. Let's start with London. So most Western cities in the 1930s are characterised by the Depression, but the decade has also been reappraised by historians as one of burgeoning affluence and modernity that lay the groundwork for the post-war boom. It was a decade in which the retail landscape of London changed irrevocably for many reasons. There was the rise of ready-to-wear clothing, the decline of court dressmaking, the spread of the suburbs, and the emergence of chain stores. This in turn led to a surge of consumerism, which was helped by an increase in real wages, home ownership, and consumer durables. It was also a boom time for certain culture industries as well. There was a growth in Britain of a national London-centric press, and more importantly, of course, there was the cinema. Now, cinema attendance in Britain in the 30s was at an all-time high, with an average of 18.5 million people visiting the silver screen each week by 1934, numbers that cinema chains today could really only dream of. They were really riding the crest of excitement brought about by the introduction of the talkies here at the end of the 1920s. The importance of cinema is really clear from its architecture, as you can see here. The grand movie theatres have been labelled lush Rococo palaces, and you can really see why. So this here is the Troxy in Stepney, which originally opened as a grand cinema in 1933. And it was designed to seat an audience of 3,520 people. You're quite amazing. The staff at the cinema were even in evening dress. I mean, I can only imagine, it must have been incredible. And this is also the Granada Cinema in Tooting, which was built in 1931. Now, what I think is interesting about these cinemas is that they're not in the West End. You didn't have to go to Leicester Square to have this kind of experience. You know, this is Tooting in Stepney. It was really happening all over the country. Okay, so moving on to the rivalry between America and Paris. There's a huge dichotomy set up between the two that still exists today to a certain extent. Paris has always been characterised in terms of elegance, elite styles, chic, beauty and impracticality, whereas American is seen as casual, democratic, sportswear influenced and active. However, this view, which tends to be the norm in terms of fashion history, is somewhat of an exaggeration. Chanel in Paris, here on the left, had been revolutionising women's fashion. She'd been making it more practical, using fabrics associated with sportswear like tweed and jersey, fabrics associated with menswear as well. She'd been dressing liberated modern women really since around about 1915, 1916, since really quite early. So it's not, Paris wasn't just about the sort of impractical and elite clothing that we tend to think of it as. This is Chanel by the coast in France in 1930. Also, Schiaparelli had been challenging people's conceptions of good taste. This is one of her designs here on the right. She was involved in numerous collaborations with artists, specifically people like Jean Cocteau and Salvador Dali as well. This dress was actually a collaboration with Salvador Dali. Now this skeleton dress was really quite heavily criticised when it was first designed. People saw it as the height of bad taste. So again, it challenges that idea of Paris as always being about elegance and refinement and good taste. It wasn't necessarily the case. So connections between Paris and Hollywood had existed tenuously since the 1920s. When MGM employed Erte, the illustrator Erte, to design costumes for a number of films. And the relationship continued sporadically throughout the 1930s, as both Chanel and Schiaparelli, funnily enough these two here, were engaged to dress Gloria Swanson and Mae West, respectively. During the 1920s, silent film stars were generally expected to provide their own costumes for films that had contemporary settings. Now, of course, there were exceptions to this. Much as I would love to have those pieces in my own wardrobe to just pluck out. Now the exceptions were the costume pictures such as those of Gloria Swanson and Cecil B. DeMille in the late teens and the early 20s. This is male and female here. Cecil B. DeMille famously said, "I want clothes that will make people gasp when I see them. I don't want to see any clothes that anybody could possibly buy in a store." And next to Gloria Swanson is an early version of Cleopatra starring Theda Bara. Now at this point, stars had to colour their faces with unnatural shades to show up on the film stock. So to achieve this look, apparently Theda Bara had to paint her face yellow and her lips brown, which is somewhat less glamorous than the effects that you see here. However, the majority of films that were made that were set in a contemporary time frame were much less spectacular in terms of costume, and they rarely used what we would term today a costume designer. Throughout the 1920s, there was also a huge growth in fan magazines. These gorgeous examples can be found here at the British Library. They're from the collections here. This is Photoplay, which is American, and Picturegoer, which is British. They're really great sources of information in terms of films and fashion throughout this period. Now, Hollywood in the 1930s took on a very different air to Hollywood in the 1920s. The Hays Code was brought into effect in 1933. This was an attempt to clean up Hollywood after the debauchery, perceived debauchery of the 1920s, of the Jazz Age. Now, the economic circumstances were very different by this point, and people had less tolerance for those kind of high-flying Hollywood lifestyles that were all about sort of recklessness and partying and drinking and drugs and those kind of things. There were a few high-profile scandals, specifically one involving Fatty Arbuckle, and people had had enough. And there were rumours that the government was going to regulate the output of Hollywood. And so to get around that, Hollywood decided to regulate itself. They brought in this guy, Will Hays, and he came up with this code that was essentially a sort of a morality code that said what people could and couldn't show in the films. which is why the films that you get towards the sort of, well, towards the middle of the 1930s tend to have a very different kind of feel to the films in the 1920s. They're a lot less risque in many ways. Also, there was the Depression, of course, during the 1930s. You can't ignore that. And this meant that government and business were really pushing for domestic produced products to bolster the economy. Now, Hollywood was a perfect example of this, and it was used as a tool to promote and sell American products across the world. Women during the 1930s were seen as the major consumers, both for themselves and for their households and families. And they were also seen as the prime movie watchers, so it made financial sense to develop a fiercely commercial aspect to the movies. So there were product tie-ins, especially fashion product tie-ins, and these really permeated all levels of the industry. The star system at the time encouraged total stardom. Stars' lives were managed to the utmost degree, and personalities were formed by studios as well as the, you know, star's name. Their whole personality could be kind of moulded by what the studio wanted. Now, this operated as insurance against the production cost of the picture, the idea being that if the star had fans, if you were a particular type, and you appeal to a certain demographic of people, then all of those people will go and see your movie and the studio was guaranteed to make its money back on the film. And this is really evident in film and fan magazines at the time. stars really were set out like types, like particular sort of personality types. And so fashion could be sold in the same way according to your type. I like to think of it as a little bit like an early version of the Spice Girls. And so costume designers came to be promoted as well. There was Travis Banton at Paramount, Gilbert Adrian at MGM, who I'll be coming on to later, and John Ori Kelly, mainly at Warner Brothers. Very soon, designers became as influential as Parisian couturiers. They gave tips in magazines, they had radio shows, they later had TV shows. They were celebrities in their own right. Studio designers such as Travis Banton were still sent seasonally to Paris to observe the trends. However, by the early 1930s, it was also a period when Hollywood began to promote the idea of itself as originator rather than follower of fashions. And this is evidenced in fan magazines at the time. They really aggressively promoted the originality of Hollywood styles through fashion spread layouts. For example, one article, it was about styles created by Howard Breer for Virginia Valley in Photoplay in 1930. It's an American fan magazine. And it says about this particular dress, it exemplifies the typical Hollywood line, which Paris now calls new, but which Hollywood created. You get this kind of thing dotted throughout fan magazines throughout this period, nonstop. There's this sort of ongoing, underlying current pushing the idea of Hollywood being at the forefront of trends, Hollywood being the creator, the originator. At the same time, the clothing industry in New York, based around 7th Avenue, began promoting American design for the first time. Before that, American designers were nameless. You might get designers designing for big department stores, that kind of thing, but it was a very, very different system to the system in Paris. It was a system based around the idea of mass production. And it was only in the very early 1930s that you started to get American design being promoted specifically as named American design by American designers. Hollywood really encouraged commercial reproduction of its styles, unlike Paris. Paris had a huge problem with counterfeiting, hated it. Hollywood was kind of almost the opposite. The Modern Merchandising Bureau that was set up acted as a middleman between the studios and clothes manufacturers. So studios would supply the Modern Merchandising Bureau with sketches from various films to be produced and sold. The Bureau created a franchise called Cinema Fashions Shops, and by 1937 there were apparently more than 400 of these shops across the country. This also meant that the names of the studio designers became well known to the public. And you can really see that this was a hugely beneficial promotion system, both for fashion and for film. It was, you know, both of them got a lot out of this kind of promotion and publicised product. Ready-made clothing lines such as this promoted cults of fandom and the idea of copying your favourite star, something we see all too often today in celebrity-driven magazines. It really sets up links between notions of fashionability and the Hollywood lifestyle. Costume became an integral part of the myth-making process of the dream machine. Stories were leaked to the press about the immense value of costumes, and clothes horse stars like Joan Crawford really embodied notions of glamour and its importance both on and off screen. So with this, you get the rise of the fashion show sequence in films. Now there are lots of fantastic examples of fashion show sequences from films at this time, and I'm going to show you just one of them. So this is from 1935, from a film called Roberta.
This polo rig, of course, and for an added 1,000 francs, we furnish horses. Or if you're doing skids on skis at St. Moritz, you'd be best dressed for a dollar on the courses. Now take the dowager who is glad to leave her watchman for tea. She'd wear this patriotic plaid and meet that Scotchman for tea. Ah, when summertime begins, this costume always wins. When 50 million little Frenchmen clap their hands. For hunting grouse or quail, Roberta ran up this suit. The modest price includes the bag, the gun, and 2 ducks to shoot. And should Amelia Earhart care to get a breath of air, this is the last thing in the world she'd ever wear.
Are we getting it?
The princess begs to be excused. We are leaving for Rome immediately, the show is finished.
It's the hour for dry martinis. Parks full of little boards and ice on machines. The Ritz bar is serving caviar and wings. Madame is there. And from Roberta, she has something that's too divine on, the sort of thing your jealous friends would have loved to spill their wine on. For your inspection, our cocktail collection.
Thank you. monument they call the Eiffel Tower. We'll show you the gown we made in Paris, Queen of Romania. We also ran a three of these for Mrs. Smudge, Pennsylvania. The lights are low. Here we go.
Fashion show sequence, it's not really incidental in the film. It's quite long and quite lingering and quite involved. It's literally a fashion show being shown on film. And the reason for that is that 15 of those costumes, or of the costumes from the film, were apparently reproduced by the Modern Merchandising Bureau. So you can see why they, you know, spent so long literally showing all of those details, showing those different angles of the women in that fashion show, because a lot of those pieces would have actually been available to buy in a slightly more sort of daywear style version, I think. So you can also see from this film that even clear box office winners like Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers were expected to take on fashion as a subject at this time. This film, it's a kind of about a European fashion house that ends up being run by Americans. The plot is kind of almost incidental in this film, to be honest. The real subject of this film is fashion, is very much fashion. And that comes across especially from this show, which happens very near the end of the film. It's like this big crescendo that everything's kind of been building up to. Now, rumours were spread by the studio that the costumes in this film were worth over $1 million. It doesn't sound that much today, but at the time, it's not an awful lot of money. It wasn't actually true, but it was all part of the hype of the movie. It was all part of the information that was being used to really sell the film. The film costumes were designed by Bernard Newman, who was also the head designer for Bergdorf Goodman. So again, there's a really nice kind of parallel between the worlds of fashion and film going on. And it's great if you listen to the lyrics of Fred Astaire's song. It's quite funny, and it's interesting the way that he, you know, the sort of relationship, the sort of jokey relationship that he has, that American fashion has with Parisian sort of couture. A lot of it comes through in his lyrics. I especially like the bit with the sportswear section at the beginning where he says, talks about Amelia Earhart, and he says, this is the kind of thing she'd never wear. Really showing that it was kind of impractical, not actually practical at all. So these fashion show sequences within these films became a mix of American sportswear styles, as you could see at the beginning, and Parisian high elegance with a heavy dash of Hollywood glamour thrown in for good measure. They sold to the world a version of American fashion that encapsulated both the seductive glamour of Hollywood and the egalitarian nature of mass-produced, ready-to-wear from around New York. So, London and Hollywood. Polite society associated Hollywood with notions of vulgarity throughout the 1920s. The imagined depravity of Tinseltown during the hedonism of the Jazz Age, which resulted in the production code in the early 1930s, ensured that Hollywood was far from sharing the morality and ideals of Middle England. Costume played a vital role in this. Typically supplied by the actress herself throughout the 1920s, clothing during the silent era focused on symbolism and spectacle rather than realism, which didn't sit well with middle-class conceptions of taste and respectability. This was evident throughout British Vogue during the earliest years of the 1930s, when Hollywood is conspicuous by its absence. However, the coming of sound heralded a new era in Hollywood's history, one that valued realism, if somewhat exaggerated, and fashion consciousness in dress, which created commercial opportunities, as I've discussed, and also directly contributed to the power of the mise-en-scene. Now, this shift in perception occurs simultaneously with a rise in middle-class cinema attendance in Britain, and it's played out on the pages of Vogue. Now, I think that that's quite interesting, that there's that rise in middle-class attendance. It's that sort of idea that, you know, the middle classes quite often see themselves as cultural arbiters, or sort of custodians, and once they approve of something, then it's all right for the working classes to be doing it as well. Fashion and film magazines were closely related due to the belief that consumption and movie attendance were inextricably aligned with femininity. So the majority of film publications included fashion sections, even in the magazines that were aimed at men as well. So this is one of my favourites. This is from Film Pictorial, a British magazine. And it really shows how film magazines were used to sell fashion, learn C-style from the stars. I mean, this isn't a million miles away from what we kind of see today, where you get one trend being worn by lots of different celebrities kind of cut out on a page. It's the same concept, basically. So British magazines such as Film Pictorial placed Hollywood at the pinnacle of notions of fashionable consumption. This was constructed through spreads like this and by articles of people like Gloria Swanson, which would advocate a glamorous life achieved through what they were buying and wearing, kind of conspicuous consumption. So the turning point for British fashion magazines, specifically Vogue, can be pinpointed to 1932 with the release of the Joan Crawford movie Letty Linton. Now, this is a really pivotal film in fashion and film history, even though it's hardly ever been seen. It's been unavailable since the mid-1930s because it was the subject of a copyright trial shortly after it was released. At the moment, it's locked in some basement archive somewhere in deepest America, somewhere. No one ever sees it. However, it's gone down in sort of Hollywood film and fashion sort of myth. This dress of exaggerated organdy ruffles, which was designed by Adrian for Joan Crawford, has become part of Hollywood costume myth, both for the copies that were allegedly but not actually sold through the Modern Merchandising Bureau, because they like to sort of bump up their numbers, but also for the far-reaching influence that the dress has been fabled to have on fashion trends for the following two decades. Now, if you think about the strong shoulders that were in fashion throughout the end of the 1930s and the majority of the 1940s, many people credit that to this very dress. Now, while it's generally accepted that the big shoulder was an exaggeration of a feature initiated by Schiaparelli in Paris, there can be no doubt that costume designer Adrian popularised this motif for a wider audience. Now you can immediately see the Letty Linton influence in British Vogue. They start taking America more seriously in their articles as a style influencer, and they run pieces that say things like, to be fluent in French is not nearly such an asset at a modern party as to be fluent in American. That's from an article in March 1933. However, it was the next month, in April 1933, that Vogue eventually gives full credence to the idea that Hollywood could influence fashion. They ran an article called Does Hollywood Create? And the article validates Hollywood costume for the first time, and it situates the creations of costume designers alongside the rarefied designs of Parisian couturiers who, in this article, remain nameless. The article even features the Letty Linton dress itself, and it recognises its influence as well. It says, lots of little girls who saw the picture felt that they would die if they couldn't have a dress like that, with the result that we have been flooded with little Joan Crawfords. And this Linton influence is suddenly evident throughout Vogue fashion advice. This is 1932, Nancy Beaton, photographed by her brother Cecil. Check out the shoulders. And here again, this is April 1933 by Horst, from an article called Shoulder Frills in the Ascendant. And then here, this is really nice, this again is from the British Library, you can see it really trickle down the fashion system. This demonstrates a really wearable version of shoulder detailing and is a really nice example of Adrian's maxim of above the table dressing. This was his idea that for movie costume, because so much of it was shot in close-up, the most important details that you could have on clothing would be around the neckline, the shoulders, things that would really frame the face. That was his kind of idea. And you can see that really nicely in these sort of home dressmaking patterns that have these sort of frills and shoulder details. They're very subtle, they're very wearable. You can really see the influence kind of trickling down. And finally, even more evidence that Hollywood has been accepted by Vogue. These are Adrian designs for Norma Shearer, which feature in Vogue in 1938. So to sum up, the increasing coverage of Hollywood within the pages of Vogue really laid the foundation between style and the silver screen that we still see today at events like the Oscars, where the red carpet basically acts as a catwalk. Also, the product placement of fashion or fashion tie-ins that we see in films like The Great Gatsby from last year, where the fashion element is really used as a marketing tool. This again highlights the consistent links between the worlds of fashion and film that we see so often today, but that actually started way back in the Jazz Age. And with that, I'd like to hand over to Chris.